Little ones, you are dismissed. Go in God's peace. I feel like I just, did Bond just go, yes? Did I hear that? That's what most people say at the end of church most of the time. It's like, yes, Andrew's done talking. Would you join me in a word of prayer? Lord God, Heavenly Father, we just proclaimed and sang some very bold words that only through your Son, Jesus, do we find salvation, that he is the only one that saves, that you are worthy of all of it, that you're worthy of every song we sing, you're worthy of everything we say about you, you're worthy of every breath that we take towards you, God. We believe that to be true. So, Father, may the words of my mouth and the meditation of our hearts in this place be a pleasing thing in your sight. May these words not be heard as my own, but from you through your Holy Spirit. In Jesus' name we pray, and all God's people said, amen. So there's a phrase that you hear a lot when you think about somebody that has come into a specific place and has spent a lot of time there and has changed that place for the better, okay? And we call that, we'll say that that is the house that this particular person built, okay? That's what we call it when somebody, maybe they didn't actually physically build that place, but they came into that place when it needed some improvement, and they changed it for the better, and they made it better, and they made it, they transformed it essentially. And so when people look back, they go, that is the house that this person built. For example, back in the 1940s, the UCLA basketball team was not a lot to look at, okay? They had a losing record every year. They were getting worse and worse and worse until a young guy in his 30s, yes, I say young guy in his 30s, 30s, I still consider young, thank you very much. A young guy in his 30s came along. He came out from the cornfields of Indiana to sunny Southern California, and he changed this basketball program. 10 national championships later, this program was changed into a dynasty. This young man was named John Wooden. You may have heard of him. Arguably the greatest basketball coach to ever live, college or pro. 10 national championships, awards, accolades, conference championships. I mean, you name it. He had the most incredible success in the history of UCLA. And now, UCLA's home gym, Pauley Pavilion, goes by another name to the locals, okay? Because even though Coach Wooden had nothing to do with the actual construction of this stadium, they now call it the house that John built. That's a statue of John Wooden right outside Pauley Pavilion. And friends, there are plenty of other examples of this, right? Where somebody just comes into a place that needs improvement, that is a little worse for the wear, and changes it for the better, and does amazing things through this place. And then when people look back, they say, this is the place, this is the house that he built, or this is the house that she built. It's transformative. In the epistle reading that you heard co-read this morning, we hear about a man named Moses. Now, I mean, even if you don't go to church, even if you're not a Christian, I think you'd have to be living under a rock to never hear the name Moses in your life or have never heard about him. Some of you may have read a lot about Moses, but typically as Christians, we have this kind of pecking order, don't we, of biblical characters? Like if you've read the Bible a lot and you have this list of all these guys or girls and it's like, yeah, these people, they did great things, they were awesome, but I mean, they're not perfect. They're definitely not as high as Jesus is. But in our minds, sometimes we have this ranking, but friends, it is imperative this morning that we read this epistle passage that co-read to us. It's imperative that we read this as the first group of people that read this, okay? Because it is, it changes the way that you read this passage. Now, does anyone remember the actual epistle that Ko read from this morning? Are we serious? Is this happening right now? This is actually happening right now. Hebrews! Larry for the win. Hebrews, okay? So, to go even further down, and this is not to condescend anybody, we got to go down this train. So that means that who was this written to? Hebrews! Good! Now, which means then that Hebrews is another way of saying who? Jewish. These are devout Jews that are reading this letter for the first time, okay? These are devout Jews. These were God's chosen people. These were the ones that they had ancestors that wandered in the wilderness with God. I mean, these were people that they could trace their lineage back to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. And who do you think was the rock star for these people? Moses. Moses, man. You could not get any better than Moses. And if you're not convinced, Mark, you can go to the next slide. I thought I'd put together just a little bit of a resume for you of Moses' accomplishments, okay? So try matching this in your own life. I dare you. Moses' resume: led God's people out of slavery in Egypt, parted the Red Sea with his staff, spent 40 days and nights on a mountain with God, with God, guys. Like, Moses is here, God is literally right here. Like, that's the kind of with that we're talking about. Received the Ten Commandments from God's own hand. Like, what does that even mean? What's that like? Led Israel through the desert to the promised land. He was known as the lawgiver of Israel. The first five books of the Bible, we call it the Pentateuch, we call it the Torah. Some people call it, particularly Jews to this day, call it the Law of Moses. That's what it was entitled. Traditionally known as the author of the Pentateuch and the first five books of the Bible. After his death, he was buried by God himself. What does that look like? What does that even mean? Buried by God himself. And if you're not convinced, look back at Deuteronomy 34, just in verse 10 that Ko read to us. The Bible even backs up the greatness of Moses. I don't know if you caught this. Since then, no prophet has risen in Israel like Moses, whom the Lord knew face to face. Incredible. Verse 11, who did all those signs and wonders the Lord sent him to do in Egypt, to Pharaoh and to all his officials, and to his whole land. The greatness of Moses. For no one has ever shown mighty power or performed the awesome deeds that Moses did in the sight of all Israel. And if that's not enough, guys, I am going further down this rabbit trail. Follow me at your own caution. But there are some ancient Jewish texts as well that talk about how great Moses was. Next slide, Mark. There's a bunch of different things that have been written about Moses. Now, these are all different sources, but these are all like trusted, reliable Jewish, like there are rabbis, there are historians. These are things that were written about Moses that aren't even in the Bible. This is how great Moses was. Moses was called the father of wisdom on account of his great sagacity. We all know what that means, right? Sagacity, come on. He possessed 49 of the 50 divisions of wisdom. Not sure what that means, but if there are 50 divisions of wisdom and Moses has 49 of them, I mean, that's pretty impressive, isn't it? Piety was not burdensome to him. So, like, it wasn't hard for Moses to be great. It wasn't hard for him to be amazing. His prayers were immediately answered. He was so prominent a figure that his authority was equal to that, and I love this, of an entire Sanhedrin of 71 members. So 71 devout Jewish rabbis equaled one Moses. That's how great Moses was. Or even of the whole of Israel. Next slide, Mark. No place received his body. His sepulcher is from the rising of the sun to the setting thereof, and from the south to the confines of the north, all the world is his sepulcher. Philo also calls Moses the mediator and reconciler of the world. Especially in Essene churches, Moses was apotheosized next to God, says Josephus. They honor the name of their legislator, and if anyone blasphemes him, the name of Moses, he is met with capital punishment. Guys, how is that for a resume? I mean, honestly, this is how the Jewish people today still view Moses. I mean, imagine if that was your resume. Like, one Fountain of Life member equals 72 Christian pastors. That's how holy and pious this person is today. This person was, I mean, if anyone blasphemes this person's name, they will receive the death penalty immediately because of how holy and revered this person was. And all of this can be summed up by saying, you know, as a Jewish person, you'd say all of the customs that we do, all of our traditions, all the things that we were about, this is just the house that Moses built. This is the house that Moses built. And then in the first century, these devout Hebrews, these devout Jews, they get a letter. They get a letter written to them. And this letter says this, and look back at Hebrews 3 that Co read, starting at verse 1. And we got to look at this slowly if you're reading this as somebody who is a devout Jewish person. Therefore, holy brothers and sisters who share in the heavenly calling, fix your thoughts on who? What? Fix your thoughts on not on Moses? Fix my thoughts on Jesus? Now, you got to understand that these were devout Jews, but they had been the gospel had been shared with them. So they were sort of being swayed over to believe in this good news of Jesus Christ. However, you don't just give up all of your Judaism, all of your customs, all of your beliefs like that. So they're struggling right now with how to live, how to view different people, how to view Moses, how to view Jesus. Fix your thoughts on Jesus, whom we acknowledge as our apostle and high priest. He was faithful to the one who appointed him. Just as Moses was faithful in all God's house, Jesus has been found worthy of greater honor than Moses. Just as the builder of a house has greater honor than the house itself, Jesus has been found worthy of greater honor than Moses. No, you didn't. No, not even, no way. Are you kidding me right now? The resume that we just went through, you're telling me there's a guy that's greater honor than that? I mean, that would, honestly, guys, it's like coming up to an American and saying, you know, there was a greater president than Abraham Lincoln. There was a greater public speaker than Martin Luther King Jr. There was a greater hockey player than Wayne Gretzky, who is literally nicknamed the Great One. There's a greater one than that. There was a greater person than all of these people. There was a smarter scientist than Albert Einstein. I mean, we can keep going on and on, but it's like heresy. It's like actual heresy to say that Jesus has been found worthy of greater honor than Moses. So a group of devout Jews are being told here, wait, I'm fixing my thoughts on, not on Moses. I'm not supposed to be obedient to Moses. I'm supposed to fix my eyes on Jesus. What do you do with that? I mean, really, what do you do with that if this has been your way of life, your entire life? These have been your customs. These have been your traditions. In that moment, these Hebrews are faced with the reality that the kingdom of God is like a house. Yes, Moses was an awesome servant. He was a faithful servant in that house. But guys, in that culture, who do you think was more highly revered? The servant in the house or the son who lives in the house? The son of the father who built that house. The Son who receives all the inheritance and the blessings from the Father who built that house. A Son who has always been living in that house. I mean, that's what this letter is saying to this group of Hebrews. And then we look at verse 6. But Christ is faithful as the Son over God's house. And here's where we come in, friends. And we are his house, if indeed we hold firmly to our confidence and the hope in which we glory, or the hope in which we boast. If our boasting is in this Son, if our confidence is in Christ and Christ alone, then we are the house of God. We are the place where God dwells. So this was a humbling thing, you can imagine. After looking at that resume, this was a humbling thing for a group of Jews to accept. But my question this morning is, how much more humbling do you think it is for 21st century Americans to also hear things like, God is the builder of this house. God is the builder of your life. God and God alone. That you are not the builder of this life. You know, we have a couple of phrases that we use in our culture that we love to use. Finish some of these for me if you would. I picked myself up by my own bootstraps. What was the other one? This one's simple. I did it all by myself. I built it with my own two hands. I mean, there's such a pride in that, isn't there? I mean, there's such a pride that we have for some reason of knowing that we did something all on our own, knowing that we did it without help, knowing that we did it just completely, completely by ourselves. See, sometimes we are our own little Moseses, aren't we? We think, you know, my life, we want to look back on our life at the end of it and say, this is the house that I built. This is what I created on my own, by myself, with my own two hands. That's what we want to say for some reason at the end of our life. And then the writer of Hebrews brings us back to reality in this passage. Remember who built you. Remember who is building you every day. Remember who is breaking you down at times to build you back up anew. Remember who the builder of your life is, and spoiler alert, it's actually not you. And some of us, that's tough to hear, isn't it? But some of us, that's comforting to hear, to know that I'm not actually in control of the outcomes of my life, to know that there's somebody else that is building me every day. There's somebody else that is responsible when I succeed. There's somebody else that is never going to leave my side when I fail. Somebody else is the builder. Your body is the house that God built. The church is the house that Christ built. And when we say church, friends, let us not be deceived to think that church, we just mean this physical building that we show up to every Sunday morning. Church means if we are the house of God, that means we as a people are a house of God. So we could have wheels on this building because we are to be a mobile church. We can be a house of God anywhere we go. Because our calling is to do what? To come in and receive, and then to go out and tell. To go out and invite. To go out and remind others who built them. Who is building them up every single day. And apparently, to hammer this home, the writer of Hebrews returns to this idea. Now, this isn't in your bulletins and it's not going to be up on the screen, but I would invite you just to listen to these two verses. Towards the end of Hebrews, it all comes full circle. The writer says this, Therefore, since we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, let us throw off everything that hinders and the sin that so easily entangles, and let us run with perseverance the race marked out for us, fixing our eyes on Jesus. There's that phrase again. Fixing our eyes on Jesus. Staying focused on Jesus, the pioneer and the perfecter of faith. For the joy set before him, he endured the cross, scorning its shame, and sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. You know, on Wednesday, we're going to enter into this season that we call Lent. And like I said earlier, for some of you, if you're not familiar with Lent, we'll talk more about it on Wednesday, but if you're not going to be joining us on Wednesday, Lent, in a nutshell, it's an intentional time of preparation, okay? It's an intentional time where we prepare our hearts for all the things that are about to happen to Jesus in Scripture. We follow down the road to the cross right alongside Jesus. So we prepare our hearts. Now, some of you may just be literalists. So you hear this and you go, okay, preparing my heart sounds very nice and fluffy and like Hallmark Channel-y, but I don't really know how you do that. Like, how do you actually prepare your heart? Like, I'm not a surgeon. I can't go in there and physically do something to my heart to get it ready. Like, what does that mean? Well, how do we prepare our hearts? We listen to Hebrews. We listen to Hebrews 12. We throw off everything that hinders us. We throw off, or we shed off, everything that holds us back, any sins that have entangled us. Sometimes the way that you prepare yourself is by getting rid of stuff. That's why during Lent, sometimes traditionally people give things up, you know? It's not just a time where it's like, I'm going to give up chocolate for 40 days or I'm going to give up, you know, something else for 40 days. Some people, they don't give something up. They say, I'm going to devote myself to do this once a day, or I'm going to do that once a day. But it's first the throwing off of things that entangle us and run the race that you were called to run. And how do we do that? Again, because that's another just abstract analogy. How do we run the race? We fix our eyes on Jesus. We stay focused on Jesus. Stay focused implies that you can lose focus. How easy is it in our world, friends, to lose focus on Jesus? When the whole world seems to be promoting other things to you. That's why we say it's an intentional time, Lent is, of preparation. It's an intentional time where we choose to focus each and every day on Jesus. We stay focused on Jesus. Because when you hear the term run the race you were called to run, some of you may say, I don't even know what my race is. I don't even know what I'm called to do. This is where I implore you. Stay focused on Jesus. Be obedient to Jesus. Read what Jesus has to say to you. Read what he invites you into. And follow that, full-fledged, and God will make straight your path. That's God's promise, that if you stay focused on Jesus, you will find your life. You will find your race that you're meant to run. And I've grown to look forward to Lent more and more every year, simply because of this fact. Because it's a time where we put ourselves back where we belong. We put ourselves back in the place where we belong. Because our calling, friends, is not to pick ourselves up by our bootstraps. Our calling is not to look back on our lives and say, I did it all myself. Our calling in life is to surrender. It's to surrender to God, to remember who we are reliant on. For breath, for life, and for salvation every day of our lives. So as you enter into this time of Lent, this time of preparation, my prayer for you and my invitation for you, stay focused. Stay focused on Jesus every day. Listen for his voice. If you say, I can't hear his voice, open this up. Jesus makes it pretty clear in here. His voice is promised to be heard in here. Stay focused and remind yourselves every day who is the builder and who is the house. Would you join me in a word of prayer?